إن الحمد لله إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالًا كثيرًا ونساءً واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أحسن الكلام كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار ثم أما بعد Indeed, all praises are for Allah سبحانه وتعالى The one who is deserving of all praise. We praise him, we glorify him, and we thank him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who has created us, the one who has provided for us, and the one who continues to sustain us. We praise and we glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has bestowed upon us countless flavors and blessings. فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ Which of the favors and blessings of your Lord will you deny? We praise and we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has selected and chosen us to be from amongst those who say لا إله إلا الله that there is no God, there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah Azza wa Jal. And we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has guided us to al-Islam. We praise and we glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has sent down the Quran as huda lil-muttaqeen, as a huda, as a guidance to those who are conscious, to those who fear him. And we praise and we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has sent down the best of his creation, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as bashiran wa nadhira, as a bringer of glad news, as a bearer of glad tidings, and as a warner against the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is narrated by Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إنما الأعمال بالنيات وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى That indeed, most certainly, definitely, our actions are based upon their intention. And that every person, every man, will have the reward for what he intended. يا عباد الله This is a hadith that we must pay a special importance to. It is a hadith that when we grasp it and understand it and implement its concept, it can lead to our actions being accepted and our actions being good. Or if we are unable to do so, they can destroy us and leave our actions in vain. In a hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentions and he narrates to us and he tells us about a dialogue, a conversation that will take place on Yawmul Qiyamah, a conversation between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and a group of people who will be from amongst the first to enter the fire. وَنَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ مِنَ النَّارِ. On Yawm al-Qiyamah, a man will be brought before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a man who fought in the path of Allah subhanahu. He gave his health, his strength, and he sacrificed his life fighting in the path of Allah in jihad fi sabilillah. And this man, he was martyred, he was killed in Allah's path. When he is brought before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on Yawmul Qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remind him of the favors and bounties that he gave him. And this man will say that, Ya Allah, yes, you have blessed me with this favor and that favor. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask him, what is it that you did? What is it that you did to show gratitude for the favors that I have given you? The man will say, Ya Allah, that I sacrificed, I gave the ultimate of sacrifices. I sacrificed my life in jihad. I sacrificed my life fighting in your path. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to him, Kadhabt. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, Kadhabt, that you have lied. That the only reason that you went out and fight in the path of Allah subhanahu, the only reason that you went out in jihad, the only reason that you went out is so that the people, they will see you and they will call you brave. The people will say that you are courageous. The people will say that you are a warrior. And they have done so. So Allah Azza wa Jal will issue the command. He will give the command for this man to be held and dragged by his face and flung and thrown into the fire. Then another will be brought before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A man who Allah, he blessed him and allowed him to attain the knowledge of the deen. He allowed him to attain the knowledge of the Qur'an. He allowed him to perfect the recitation of the Qur'an. And on that day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when this man is standing in front of Allah, Allah will remind him of the favors and bounties that he gave to him. And the man will say that, yes, Ya Allah, indeed, I have been blessed in this way. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask him, just as he asked the one before him, he will say, how did you make benefit? How did you show gratitude for the favor that I have given you? And the man will say, Ya Rabb, that I attained and I strove and I struggled and I attained the knowledge of your deen and I taught it to the people. And I learned how to recite the Qur'an, and I taught the Qur'an to the people, and I recited your words for them, Ya Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him the same response. He will say, Kadhabt, that you have lied. That the only reason that you attain knowledge, and the only reason that you taught the people, is so that they will call you an alim, that they will call you a scholar. And the only reason that you recited the words of Allah, you recited the Qur'an for the people, will be so that they call you a qari. And the people have done so. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again will issue the command for this man to be taken and dragged by his face and flung into the fire. A third man will be brought before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a man whom Allah, He blessed him with wealth. And this man, he spent his wealth and he gave sadaqah, he gave charity. And when he stands in front of Allah, and Allah reminds him of the favors and bounties that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him, the man will acknowledge these favors of Allah. So Allah will ask him as he asked the two before him. He will say, "What is it that you have done? How did you use the favors that I have given you to show and be grateful? What benefit did you make of the favors that I gave you?" And the man will say that, "Ya Allah, Ya Rabb, I gave my wealth. I spent it in sadaqah. I spent it fi sabilillah. That whatever I earned, whatever you gave to me, I gave it. I gave it back and I spent it fi sabilillah." Allah Azza wa Jal will say again, "Kathabt," that you have lied. That the only reason that you gave sadaqah and you gave charity is so that the people will see you and they will say that this man, he is generous. They will say that this man, he is generous. And like the two before, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will issue the command, will issue the order, will give the order for him to be dragged by his face and thrown and flung into Jahannam. Ayyuha al-Muslimun, if we were to see these people among us, if we were to see a man going out in jihad and we have heard that he was martyred, if we were to see a man teaching the knowledge of the deen, reciting the Quran, teaching the people Quran, and if we were to see a man donating his money generously, donating from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided him, we would look at him or her and say, "Alhamdulillah, mashallah, that these people, they have done well, they have done excellent." But it is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who knows what is inside of your hearts. It is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who knows the reason why you have done whatever actions you have done. It is only He who knows the purpose behind every action that you do. So we ask ourselves, where is the reward for these people? That they have struggled, they have strove, they have done apparently good actions, actions that should be pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So where is their reward? It is unjust. Rather, it is as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned, as in the hadith that we mentioned before, وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى, that every man, every person, every individual will have the reward for which they intended. As for the first of these men, we see that he went out onto the battlefield and he was martyred. But he did not go out in the path of Allah, seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu. Rather, he went out seeking the pleasure of the people. And that is what he got. He received the reward of the people. The people said that he is courageous, that he is brave, and that he is a warrior. As for the second, we see a man who struggled and he strove. It is difficult to attain knowledge, and this man, he struggled and attained the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He gained the knowledge of the Quran and he perfected its recitation. But he did not do so seeking the pleasure of Allah Rabbul Alameen. He sought the pleasure of the people, he sought the eyes of the people, and he was given the reward for what he intended, because the people, they saw him and they recognized him and they called him an alim, they called him a qari. So he got the reward for which he intended. As for the last of them, the man who worked hard, earned his money, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed him with money, blessed him with wealth. But he did not give this wealth in the charity. He did not give his sadaqah, seeking the pleasure of Allah Rabbul Izzah. But rather, he sought the reward of the people. And that is exactly what he got. He received the reward of the people because they saw him and they complimented him and they said that, yes, you are a generous man, that you are generous, you are spending your wealth, you are giving it generously. Wallahi ya ikhwan, this concept of our intentions, making sure that our intention is good, making sure and ensuring that our intentions are pure, and always being conscious of our intentions, it is something that we all must do, because being unsuccessful in having pure intentions and sincerity in our actions is something that can either elevate us and raise our status with Allah Rabbul Izzah, or it is something that can degrade and destroy us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions in the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, he says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُبْطِلُوا صَدَقَاتِكُمْ بِالْمَنِّ وَالْأَذَى كَالَّذِي يُنْفِقُ مَالَهُ رِئَاءَ النَّاسِ وَلَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فمثله كمثل صفوان عليه تراب فأصابه وابل فتركه لا يقدرون على شيء مما كسبوا والله لا يهدي القوم الكافرين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he tells us, he says, O you who have believed, يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تبطلوا صدقاتكم بالمن والأذى, that do not invalidate, do not diminish the reward of your charities, do not cause your charity and your sadaqah to be in vain. Because when you give your wealth, you tell others about it, you constantly remind the people of what you have given. In a hadith, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentions that from amongst the groups of people that will be shaded by Allah on the day in which there is no shade except the shade of Rabbul Arsh al-Azim, that from amongst these groups will be a person who, when they gave sadaqah with their right hand, the left has no knowledge of it. That when they give their sadaqah, they give it sincerely, not seeking for people to call them generous. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is telling us about people who are the opposite in this ayah. He says, لا تبطلوا صدقاتكم بالمن والأذى كالذي ينفق ماله رئاء الناس, that do not invalidate your sadaqah, do not cause your charity and your sadaqah to be wasted because you tell the others about what you have given, because you remind the people of what you have given. Like those people who the only reason they give sadaqah, ri'a'an nas, to be seen by the people. وَلَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ, and they do not believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the last day. Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, فَمَثَلُهُ كَمَثَلِ صَفْوَانٍ عَلَيْهِ تُرَابٍ, that their example is like that of a large, smooth stone. And upon this stone is a layer of dust. فَأَصَابَهُ وَابِلٌ فَتَرَكَهُ صَلَّى, and this stone, it is hit with rain, a heavy rain, by which no trace of this dust remains. This stone has been wiped clean. لا يقدرون على شيء مما كسبوا, that they will not be able to benefit they will not be able to hold on to anything of what they have earned. All of the sadaqah that they have given, they will not be able to benefit from it. Why? يُنْفِقُ رِئَاءَ النَّاسِ. That they gave it so that the people will see them. They gave it so that people will call them generous. Wallahi, this is something very dangerous, ya ikhwan. لَا يَقْدِرُونَ عَلَىٰ شَيْءٍ مِّمَّا كَسَبُوا. That they will not hold on. They cannot benefit from any of which they have earned and worked for. In another verse of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us in Surah Al-Anfal, where He speaks about the battle of Badr. This is a battle where after the Muslims had migrated and left from Mecca and they went to Medina, the Quraysh, whatever the Muslims had left back from their property, the Quraysh gathered it and they benefited from it. They sold it on their trading expeditions. So the Muslims, they saw that a caravan of the Quraysh was returning with their property, and they went out to intercept it. So a messenger came to Quraysh and he said that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the Muslims, they have raised an army, they have gathered an army, and they are coming to attack your caravan. So call to arms, bear arms. Let us go out and defend our caravan. Let us go and defend our wealth. But these people, they simply used this as an excuse to go to fight the Muslims. Because as they were going, another messenger came to them and they said, Ya Quraysh, that your caravan is safe. It was able to take another route and it is no longer in danger from the Muslims. What did the Quraysh do? They said, we will not return. We have come out and we are not returning until we have fought the Muslims, until we have destroyed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. What will the people think? We have gathered an army and have gone to fight Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and we will come back without even engaging in them or engaging with them. So they said, no, we will go. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells the Muslims, وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ خَرَجُوا مِنْ دِيَارِهِمْ بَطَرًا وَرِئَاءَ النَّاسِ وَيَصُدُّونَ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ بِمَا يَعْمَلُونَ مُحِيطٌ. That do not be like these people who the only reason they left from their homes to go out to fight is so that the people will see them and recognize and they can be prideful amongst the people. And we see what happened to these people of Quraysh. They went out not seeking to defend their property, but to destroy the Muslims, to prevent the people from worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to avert the people from sabilillah, from the path of Allah. And what happened? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gave victory to a small amount of Muslims. This small amount of Muslims, with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they were able to defeat the armies of Quraysh. Ya ibadallah, this issue, this matter of our intention and the reason for which we do our actions, it is something that we must always be conscious of. Every act of worship that we do, every salah, every sadaqah, every fast must be done for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. It is something that if we are not cautious of, لَا يَقْدِرُونَ عَلَىٰ شَيْءٍ مِّمَّا كَسَبُوا, that every act that we have done of worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, acts that are supposed to, and they must be done for Allahu Rabbul Alameen alone, we will not be able to benefit from any of them if we allow and we do not purify and ensure that our intentions are good. Always remember this verse, يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُسْلِمُونَ لَا يَقْدِرُونَ عَلَى شَيْءٍ مِّمَّا كَسَبُوا, that we will not be able to benefit from anything if we do not first check ourselves and reflect and ensure that our actions are purely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الخلق أجمعين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. أيها المسلمون, we have discussed the importance, the utmost importance of having intentions that are to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, that our actions must be done sincerely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let us look now at the reverse of this, the opposite of this. What happens when we are insincere? What happens when the acts of worship that we do them for other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And this is ar-riya, ya ibadallah, showing off for the people, showing off as these three men that we have discussed did, that acts that are supposed to be done sincerely for Allah, they did riya an-nas, showing off for the people. Ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhu, he is reported to have said that ar-riya, showing off, it is more hidden, it is more difficult, it is harder to detect than a black ant on a black stone in the middle of a dark, moonless night. That ar-riya is something that will creep up into your heart. It will come upon you and it will taint your actions, and you may not even realize it. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, shall I not inform you of something which I fear for you? I fear this for you more than Masih al-Dajjal. Do you know what he said? He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that it is the hidden shirk. It is ar-riya. He said that it is when a man stands for salah, when a man stands to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he stands and he beautifies his salah, he beautifies his prayer, he makes it excellent, he prays it in the best of ways, so that another man may see him. Ya ibadallah, indeed, the shaitan, he has given up on convincing you Muslims to commit acts of shirk. The shaitan, he has no business in trying to whisper and convince you that you need to associate partners with Allah, that you need to sit in front of an idol or a statue and worship it, that you need to seek assistance from a grave. The shaitan, he has given up hope for the Muslims in this regard. But he will attack you. He will come after you and try his best to get you to fall into the minor forms of shirk. As Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam described, the minor shirks, the hidden shirk, ar-riya. Because ya ikhwan, when we do our acts of worship, when we perform our salah, when we give our sadaqah, when we fast, and we allow riya to creep into our hearts, we are coming very close to this. We are doing acts, we are performing actions that are supposed to be for Allahu Rabbul Izzah alone. and we are doing them to please the people. Ya ibadallah, ar-riya is something that will come upon you. It will come upon you and you will not even know. A man can come into the masjid and start his salah on the day of Jumu'ah, for example. A man enters the masjid first, and it is him alone, and he begins his salah. He begins praying extra salah. He begins his action sincerely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, seeking nearness to Allah Rabbul Izzah, seeking the reward of Allah Azza wa Jal. And then the masjid, they begin to fill. People begin to come. And he increases in his qiyam. He lengthens his ruku'. He lengthens his sujood. He beautifies the prayer, as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. He only did this after he saw the people coming. And he recognized and he said that there are people here. Let me beautify the salah so they will think that I am righteous. For this man, he did not start his salah with ar-riya in his heart. He started his salah with ikhlas, with conviction, that the only reason he is doing this and performing this salah is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But as he is praying his salah, as he is making his qiyam, his ruku', ar-riya crept into his heart. Ar-riya crept into his heart. So even while we are doing our actions that are good, our salah, our hajj, our siyam, even as we continue to do them, while we are doing them, before we are doing them, continuously, always check yourself. Because no one can know what is in your heart except Allah Rabbul Alameen and yourself. No one can come to you and have any knowledge of your intention. Only you know what you have intended an action for. And know with certainty that you will receive the reward for what you have intended. If you know within yourself that the only reason you are worshipping Allah, that you are performing your salah, is so that the people will see you and they will compliment you, then know that you will receive your reward. But your reward is not with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ayyuhal Muslimun, not more than a month ago, we left the blessed month of Ramadan. In this month, every day, we saw people flocking to the masajid, rushing to the masajid. Even if they had to sacrifice, they rushed to the masajid and they prayed their salah. We need to reflect, ya ikhwan. Were we really coming to the masajid to pray this extra salah so that we can worship Allah subhanahu? Or are we coming to the masajid so that people will see us and they will say that this man, this brother, this sister, he is always in the masjid? Whenever you feel ar-riya creeping up into you, remember what you are sacrificing. You are sacrificing the reward of Rabbul Alameen, the one who has promised you Jannah. You are sacrificing this reward for the reward of this one and that one, for the reward of so and so. What is the best that you think they can give you? The best, wallahi, is that they can come and they will compliment you. Are you willing to sacrifice the reward that is with Allah Rabbul Izzah for a compliment? Only a foolish person would give up what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised for a compliment from a person. And know with certainty that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not break and does not fail in his promise. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to be sincere in all of our actions. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala purify our intentions, and that He makes sure that we make our intentions only to serve and worship Him and to seek His pleasure and reward. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala removes all remnants and all traces of ar-riya from our hearts and our actions. رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين اللهم إنك عفو تحب العفو فاعف عنا اللهم رب ارحمهما كما ربيانا صغارا اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين وأذل الشرك والمشركين ودمر أعداء الدين اللهم انصر إخواننا المسلمين في كل مكان اللهم انصر إخواننا المسلمين المستضعفين في كل مكان اللهم انصر إخواننا المسلمين المظلومين في كل مكان ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون فاذكروا الله يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون أقيموا الصلاة